Anti-dumping, countervailing. Generally, when I speak, I usually try to abbreviate them as anti-dumping, just because it's easier in my head. However, mostly when I refer to anti-dumping, I generally refer to anti-dumping and countervailing duties. We'll figure out when, what is the difference and how it should be treated. So, having said that, let's dive in. So, anti-dumping. It has been some time since I spoken about anti-dumping duties, and since the last time I spoken, a lot of things have improved as far as information wise, and I think they improved for the better. One thing that customs have done is that since last time I spoken about anti-dumping, which was about 3 years ago or something, customs have improved their informational output to the public. So they created this dedicated web page. Yes, I know sometimes URLs are changing, but nevertheless, be mindful that this page does exist and they have all new developments that are taking place. On top of that, customs, in addition to anti-dumping duties, we have a new kid on the block, a new regulatory kid on the block, which is called Enforce and Protect Act. This is a brand new stuff. Not too much has been talked or tested about this child, but it is a creature of the Trade Enforcement and Trade Facilitation Act of 2015, which was signed by President Obama, and it made many changes in the area of customs law. They made changes in the way informal entry. They increased the price from 200 to 800. For Section 321 of the Tariff Act. They introduced a lot of changes to the duty drawback provisions, especially dealing with procedural and documentational requirement, fees, etc. And anti-dumping also has not been to, there was child labor law reporting requirements. There is many stuff that took place in the Trade Facilitation, Enforcement and Trade Facilitation Act. And one of this was Enforce and Protect Act. So please be mindful that in light of this new creature, this Enforce and Protect Act, we have a whole new regulation emerging. Let me see. The Section 165, investigation of claims of evasion of anti-dumping and countervailing duties. We are not going to talk much about it because simply it's so new. What I'd like to say about this is that under the Enforce and Protect Act, you have the new you have a congressional provision which requires that customs conduct investigations from the public about evasion of customs of anti-dumping duties, countervailing duties, mostly anti-dumping. And because customs is required to do that, they make investigation and they do the regulatory inquiry, and if they find out that it is likely to be the subject entity is likely to be evading, then they can impose sanctions in form of anti-dumping duties. So that's something which is new. This is something which, as as time goes by, this is something which I anticipate we'll be talking more and more. Another thing that I would like to bring your attention to, in addition to the trade priority issues, is that customs treats this as the one of the focus points in the enforcement frontier. And they do that because the anti-dumping duties, so, they present, first of all, a big fertile field for violations, for evasion, because simply they're so high. And additionally, create a trade issue because they are, in some cases, they enable domestic manufacturers to really remain doing in and stay in business in light of competition overseas. So just by way of example, to tell you what the anti-dumping duties are broken down as far as the trading, United States trading partners, China is huge, right? China is huge. And then you have India, South Korea, Taiwan, Japan, Brazil, Turkey, and on and on and on, all right? So orders, there are approximately 300, and this is fairly recent, but this is like 1 year old, and they constantly come about. So 373, I think the figure should be nearing 400 anti-dumping and countervailing duties, right? Dealing with various products, right? What other products? Customs, again, very, very general, right? But you have iron and steel, right? With the steel industry being a forerunner in the anti-dumping field, very protective, especially steel products for manufacturing. So it's not like the stuff that we as consumers usually see on the shelves, but this is something which the construction industry is likely to see, such as reinforced steel bars, or the oil industry will see, such as drill pipes. You have various manufacturing products, chemicals, again, iron, steel, metals, minerals, agricultural stuff, plastics, textiles, and machinery. So it's a wide range. In as far as consumer goods are concerned, they are increasing. There are increasing. So you have various products, and anti-dumping duty is usually targets commodities. So it doesn't target the industry per se, although within the scope it might, but it targets particular product by describing what it is, by looking at by providing the HTS numbers, which can be attributable to that product. And this is all in the order. So we shall shortly see what the order looks like. So going back to the outline for the anti-dumping duties, how do you define anti-dumping duty? Well, in order to grasp this concept, you have to understand the concept of normal value. So, generally speaking, and this is very, 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 very simplified, but anti-dumping duty is, so let's say there is a price of, there is United States market, right? And then there is China. Let's use China as a way of example, right? And in China, you have a product, let's say, let's call it a product, right? It can be anything. Let's say this just a glass box or paper box or whatever, and it costs $1 to produce and to sell. Let's say to produce, right? Because this is China, and I shall explain to you why. To Chinese manufacturer, it costs $1 to produce, right? So it sells that box for $2 in the United States. Now, the United States initiates the anti-dumping investigation and finds out that the box should have what's called normal value. And normal value takes into account cost of production. But because the cost of production for this box deals with China, relates to China, it is what's called market non-market economy, NME, non-market economy. So, and because it's not market economy, its pricing structure is somewhat skewed. At least that's what the United States says. So what they do is they use what's called surrogate country to determine what's normal value. And let's say they use India. How much does it cost to produce the same type of box in India? And they do their number crunching, they do their research, they do their factors of production, they do their transportation costs, they do their cost of labor, they do their cost of electricity, etc., etc., materials, etc., etc., etc. They crunch in the numbers and they figure out that the normal value is is $3. Let's say. Normal value is $3. So once you have that normal value, which is $3, then United States goes in and to say, listen, your normal value is higher than what it is in your market. Your normal value of the box should be $3, not $1. So you actually are dumping this product, and you're dumping it by the difference of $2. And because you're dumping it by the difference of $2, the anti-dumping duty rate, which we're going to impose on you, is the difference between normal value and the product that you sell in your home and the price that you dump this product at your home market. And the dumping will be, so the dumping will be, in this case, the difference between normal value and the price at the Chinese market. And the dumping here would be $2, which is $3 less $1, right? They don't look at this. They look at this structure, right? And this structure, this $1 is called export price. Export price. We never mind the stodors because they do not look at the domestic market value. They look at what's called export price. So here it is. And it is very much possible to the Chinese manufacturer to really have that cost at $1. It may even possible to sell it at 50, to make it at the cost of 50 cents and to sell it for $1 and to make a profit of it, right? But the concept of normal value is really kind of like the term of art. And the term of art means it really deals with the methodology adopted by the United States to say what the price should be, not what the price what it is. So if you like to know about more about normal value, there is a good normal value is determined by, in the United States, it's determined by the Department of Commerce. I call it DOC, Department of Commerce. And they have manual, and chapter 8 of the manual deals with the description of normal value, how they determine. So you have date of sale, course of trade, discounts, rebates, packing, movement, differences. You have various sample calculations. In other words, you have, it's very technical, very detailed. You have 85-page document of details. It's provided right over here, right? You're welcome to go to this enforcement.trade.gov, right, and take a look. It's 2015 version, but I think it's a good description if you'd like to know more about normal value. Since this is preparation for the customs license broker exam, right, I don't think we're going to go into too much of a detail of how to calculate normal value, although some of you may find it very exciting. But suffice to say, this is adjusted price of a foreign-like product in a home or third country compared. Third country here would be country like India, right? Because they consider India to be more to be market economy country as opposed to China, right? If it was India instead of China in the first place, then they can investigate India or they can investigate another third country such as Indonesia. I think that's what they've done in the case of paper products. So they adjust the price based on what Department of Commerce says the normal value should be, and they take the difference and they apply it to determine the margin. The margin can be very high. It can be as much as 400%. So this is why the stakes are so huge, especially for the importers, because the importer of record, as you recall from the previous lectures, is the party ultimately responsible for paying duties. So if the importer of record imports the product subject to anti-dumping duties, stakes are so high that they need to be very careful. They need to do extra checking to make sure that what the rate for that product is or is likely to be. All right, so here I make another example with bicycles. Right, but as I make example with a box. All right, so that's for anti-dumping duties. So this is anti-dumping, ADD. CVD, countervailing duties, on the other hand, is something different, although they're often referred to as like brother and sister, they're often referred to together. And countervailing duties, they are the creature of subsidy. There was a day when when that creature of subsidy used to be referred to somewhat differently. Let's see. So it is also provided in the Tariff Act of 1930, section 1671. Let's go to that section and take a look at how it used to be phrased.